Greetings. This video addresses a very specific request. One of the Muslims claimed that even Jesus declared only one religion, and that is Islam. He quoted Surah 351 and 385. I quoted this one of his videos here in the Philippines. It's hard for me to understand because this surah is written in Arabic. Sir, can I ask you for help about this claim? Thank you very much. I will do what I can, brother, to address this claim, and I pray that it will give you knowledge and confidence. I believe there is really one central topic you are asking about. One of the Muslim claims that even Jesus declared only one religion, and that is Islam. He quoted Surah 351 and 385. Now, there are many topical ways to address this, and I'll lay them out as an outline before I support them. 1. Any error or clever lie or deception often has a measure of truth. 2. What did Jesus actually teach? 3. What did the prophets teach? 4. What does the New Testament teach and why it matters? 5. What do Quran 351 and 385 say and does it matter? Does the Quran even have any authority to speak? 6. The burden of proof. It is the obligation of the one making the claim to provide proof. Let's take a look point by point. Any error or clever lie or deception often has a measure of truth. Let's consider that fact because the claim begins in the right location. Jesus, Yeshua, the Word of God made flesh, and that hints at the core of Islam's agenda, to steal the name of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus, Yeshua. And how does Islam try to steal Jesus? By claiming Jesus is a prophet of Mohammed's religion. Even claiming Jesus was only a prophet is part of Islam's error. We know Jesus was a prophet, Matthew 13:57, and they took offense at him. But Jesus said to them, "Only in his hometown and in his own household is a prophet without honor." Jesus referred to himself as a prophet. Mark 6:4, and Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and among his relatives and in his household." We know Jesus was the prophet Moses foretold. Deuteronomy 18:15, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your countrymen. You shall listen to him." And the people recognized Jesus as a prophet. Matthew 21:11, "The crowds replied, 'This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee.'" Luke 7:16, "A sense of awe swept over all of them, and they glorified God." Quote, "A great prophet has appeared among us," they said. "God has visited his people." There are two ways to interpret that phrase, "God has visited his people." One as a metaphor of God's blessing or presence or goodwill. And that is certainly not an inaccurate possibility. But the other meaning is harder to accept, even while being the truth. God has visited his people. The message of the prophets is that God would come. And we know God would come as a prophet. Malachi 3:1, "Behold, I am going to send my messenger, and he will clear the way before me." This is Yahweh speaking through prophet Malachi. "And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, and the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts." I am going to refer you to my series, Message of the Prophets, Part 5. 2. what did Jesus actually teach? First, Jesus never, ever said the words Islam, Mohammed, Quran, or Allah. But there is reason Jesus taught a specific belief. And in that regard, the claim is correct. There is one true way Jesus taught. John 1:17, for the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. John 14:6, Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. John 10:9, I am the gate. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. John 11:25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. John 5:21, for just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so also the Son gives life to whom he wishes. John 10:18, no one takes it, referring to his life, from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. Pay close heed, because Jesus said he could raise himself from the dead. At no time did Jesus ever say to submit to the will of Allah. And the belief or religion that Jesus taught centered on him. John 12:32, as for me, if I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself. Jesus did not say he drew men to Allah. Jesus was drawing men to himself. To myself, he said. John 6:44, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. God the Father drew mankind to Jesus. The true religion Jesus taught is worshiping the Son of God. 3. What did the prophets teach? The prophets taught God would send a prophet to Israel like Moses. Deuteronomy 18:15, the Lord your God will raise up for you, meaning for Israel, a prophet like me, meaning Moses, from among you, from your countrymen, Israelis, Jews, Hebrews. You shall listen to him. The message of the prophets is also that God would come. And we know God would come as a prophet. Malachi 3:1, behold, I am going to send my messenger, and he will clear or prepare the way before me. This is God talking. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. God's temple. The temple belongs to God. So when he's coming to his temple, the possessiveness of that noun is that God is coming. And the messenger of the covenant, in whom you delight, behold, he is coming. He's coming as a messenger, as a prophet, says the Lord of hosts. Again, I think my part 5 video goes through this in clear detail. 4. What does the New Testament teach and why it matters? The New Testament books repeat that Jesus is God come in the flesh. The new sect of Judaism that recognized Yeshua as the Messiah was called the Way. Acts 9:2, describing Saul, to ask for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any men or women belonging to the Way, he could bring them as prisoners to Jerusalem. Acts 22:4, I persecuted this Way, even to the death, detaining both men and women and throwing them into prison. The church is called the body of Christ, not the body of God, not the body of believers, the body of Christ. Again, Christ is the center of the belief, of the way to life. It was never called Islam or peace or submission to some pagan deity named Allah. 5. What do Quran 351 and 385 say, and does it matter? Does the Quran even have any authority to speak? 351, Yusuf Ali translation says, It is Allah who is my Lord and your Lord, then worship him. That is the way that is straight. Now I'm going to diverge for a moment because this is a very subtle phrasing. Even Islamic scholars agree Jesus is nothing but a sock puppet for Muhammad to say Muhammad's words. And this is exactly Muhammad's phrasing. My Allah is your Allah. And that is the core subterfuge and deception of Muhammad. That the spirit Muhammad followed as Allah is also the God of Abraham. But does it matter what the Quran says? Not really, because the Quran is confused and incoherent. Muhammad applies his best logic to deny his own claim. Surah 109, I worship not that which you worship, nor will you worship that which I worship, and I will not worship that which you have been wont to worship, nor will you worship that which I worship. To you be your way, and to me mine. I call this the Surah of Sour Grapes. Bluntly, it does not matter what the Quran says. Does the Quran even have any authority to speak? In a word, no. And the danger in giving lies any air of legitimacy is that very thing. It gives the lies of the Quran an air of actually being a holy book. The Quran was written 600 years after Yeshua was crucified and resurrected. The Quran was written 800 miles away by an ignorant man. There is nothing divine in the Quran except that which it steals from the Torah and Bible. And the last point, the burden of proof. It is the obligation of the one making the claim to provide proof. This is the logical focus which must be drawn. Muhammad bluffed his way to intimidate simple believing souls. When challenged, Muhammad never provided proof or evidence. In fact, more than once, Muhammad made his form of argument a declaration which you must disprove. Even today, this is the same baseless and unsupportable approach Muslims use. The fact is, any Muslim must produce proof from the same time as Yeshua lived. Produce proof that Allah was worshipped and people prayed toward Mecca, and that people said Shahada to Muhammad. Produce proof of any element of Islamic rituals, which are actually pagan in origin. The claim is, however, consistent with other false claims, such as prophets with Qurans sent to every nation. A false claim for which there is not one scrap of manuscript evidence. No Muslims can ever produce evidence because the claims are false. Demand evidence and proof, and without exception, they will change the subject or make up lies. I'd also like to give an overview of the subterfuge and deception. This is the crux of the matter which determines the fate of billions of souls. But it will have to wait for a part 2 as I get more time, brother. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.